You can start.
It's live.
To get started,
it's live.
Sure. Hello, all, and welcome to today's webinar on consumer analytics, metrics for success on OTT platform. Thank you for taking time out and being here today. My name is Ashish Kalvakota. I'm a product leader with end-to-end digital platform experience on products and platforms. I worked across media and entertainment industry landscape, building products for media, gaming, embedded platforms, infotainment, and edutainment segments. Today, I have Aftab as my co-presenter. He comes with 20 plus years of media domain expertise, working with large media houses. He has launched various OTT platforms at Disney, UTV, and Sony. He also has an experience around broadcast. Some housekeeping items today for all of us to know. We'll be running a live poll during the webinar and a QA at the end of the webinar. If you have any questions, feel free to just pop them in the Q&A section. We'll try to answer them as much as we can. And if you miss anything, don't worry. We are also trying to send you an on-demand recording for this session when it's available. So as a part of agenda today, we will be covering a few things. Linear TV measurement, shift in consumer watching patterns, and a little bit about the audience measurement, various metrics on digital platforms, and also, we will do a bit of deep dive on OTT metrics from the perspective of growth and engagement, revenue and marketing, and what the true North Star metrics look like. We'll also cover measurement challenges and best practices, and also quick coverage on analytical tools and technologies for 360 view of the consumer. As we all have been through, the pandemic has accelerated the adoption of a number of technologies, right? Be it online grocery, to multi-platform gaming, to streaming services, and more. So video streaming platforms and services, or what we call as OTT, over the top, are quickly becoming the de facto option for consumers around the world. And when it comes to the consumption content on TV, there are now more options than ever before, right? OTT is one, there's broadcast, there's cable, all are competing for our attention. From linear TV set to connected devices, viewers of all ages and income levels, right, be various demographics, are now able to pick and choose the what, the when, and the how of the content. How do we measure this, right? So for measuring the actual content consumption and the user behavior patterns, we actually need to understand what goes behind the mechanism of measurement and how the existing TV rating standards are working, things like that. So when we end this webinar today, there'll be three takeaways for you. The first one is, you'll get an understanding of what the OTT platform metrics are, and that matters to the content providers and advertisers. We will also discuss some best practices for implementing analytical solutions. We will also discuss the technologies and the industry standards. So let's get started. Let's get into how the linear TV rating systems work.
Thank you so much, Ashish. So understanding TV viewing pattern is critical for all parties in the media ecosystem. Media owners like broadcasters, cable guys, and other content producers need VOC information to determine who's watching their program. For that, to really price their ad inventory and make critical programming decisions. That's the critical. But on the flip side, agencies and advertisers and marketers, they need VOC information to really determine where to really spend their advertising dollars. So before really talk about all these metrics in detail, so let's understand this on the diagram on the right hand side. how the TV measurement works over here. Like we all accustomed to how data from digital side is comes and how we calculate, but again, linear side is only people from that background understand. So let's unfold that. So if you see like the panel base, like all these audio TV rating measurement happens on the panel base. Panels are actually selected. The panels are very carefully selected based on different demographics. The demographics should contain the people from different backgrounds, ethnicity, age group, gender, and even different kind of locations, so that it gives a proper picture of a TV rating. So if you see the diagram, every selected household are given some kind of meter. So meter, what it does is that it every show have some kind of audio watermark. It reads the watermark. It sends the data to the central place wherein which channel is being watched. They calculate based on the watermark. If you see in the middle, that remote, like how they calculate demographics, like this is something kind of mystery if you don't know all this thing on the TV side. So what this panel are, what they're supposed to do, if they are male, they are supposed to select a button of a male and accordingly watch that channel. Similarly for females, and whatever they're watching is all on the remote. That is how the entire demographics gets matched over there. So that's how the linear TV works over here on the panel base. And to understand the important metrics over here, the rating points and the GRPs, universe, reach, and demographics. So what is rating? So rating point is a measure of viewership of a particular television program. One single television rating point measures 1% of television household in a given minute. So the important thing is it is measured in a given minute. And 1% is that television household. So if a household is say on 25,000, the 1% will be of 25,000. And similarly, GRP and TRP, is, again, TRP is widely known, but again, usually we call it GRP. So all this linear-based advertising works on advertisement. So they are the bread and butter of thing. So again, GRPs are nothing but a measure of the performance of a TV-based advertising campaign. So it's it measures the advertising impact. And universe is a total or actual number of people in a defined target audience, which is the universe. GRPs and ratings are always used over here, and advertisers always want to know what is the reach of their advertising ads. So reach is the number of individuals from the universe who are exposed to the medium or vehicle. Reach is normally expressed in terms of percentage. So that's how this entire linear rating system works. So since we have actually moved on, like a lot of audio, people have moved on to OTT and all these things, we would really like to understand how this audience is actually on what demographics or what kind of OTT what OTT subscription you have, whether you have more than one OTT subscription. Let's have a small poll over here so that it gives a perspective of what kind of audience we have. So just allow me some seconds to run this poll. So I'll give you a few minutes, like a couple of minutes to really take this poll. So let's see how the poll is coming.
Let's keep going.
It's almost most of them have voted. So let me end the poll and let me see the results. Yeah, very interesting. So let me share with you all guys also. Can you see the poll results? Is it visible?
Yeah.
All right. So again, if you see, let me stop this sharing, and this gives a very good perspective. So if you see, I think this is exactly matching with the survey which e-marketers did sometime back in the US market. So most of the people are from this age group, 35 to 54. I think even the same figure is also reflected in the e-marketers report. One second. The same because it also reflects in the e-marketing report. So maximum like 35 to 54 age group, actually 64.4 million people are just belong to this group who have actually used some kind of OTT platform, OTT services. And the age group from 25 to 34, which is another 52 million people. So both of these from age group from 25 to 54, almost more than 110 million people have actually used some kind of at least one OTT services. So this actually shows that we are actually, the audience is flowing in the similar way. So we have seen this, the VOC continues to shift away from traditional cable or satellite providers. Why this has happened? The pace of adoption, obviously, because of COVID has accelerated that. But again, the convenience of screen from last few years, like we have tablets, mobile devices, and all the smart platform, smart TVs coming with the internet-enabled internet-enabled TVs are coming, then streaming bandwidth, the broadband is there, then 4G, 5G in some markets. So all are accelerating the demand for OTT. And in even this part of the world in India, like because of the connectivity has really become very affordable. And obviously the content which we have to choose from, like in the US alone, we have more than 200 OTT providers. And the kind of content which we can choose, maybe some are subscription-based, some are free also, is enormous. So again, you know, because of all this thing, the cord cutters, the phenomenon of cord cutters is really increasing a lot. Like from last few years in some e-marketers report, almost 31.2 million US households have already abandoned traditional TV. 64% of internet users in the US have at least one OTT subscription, which the number shows that we actually, we are the concern of adding the digital side is very important. So where this will lead to? So, well, interesting times are all ahead. Like every broadcasters and content providers are all jumping to start their own OTT service. They already started. But again, I don't think so. Broadcast as a technology, as a medium is going anywhere. Like if you see the print media is still there, why broadcasting will get killed? It will here for some time. And this is very one of the important media. It is here for, it will there for at least many years, I can say. So moving on to next slide. So we'll talk about, we spoke about the gradual shift which has happened, rating from the acceptor, and what these rating companies will do. Like they have been measuring all those traditional TV. So if they don't really rate, if they don't include the digital rating, again, the business will suffer. So that, for them is really important really to include in the panel all the digital devices as well. So total radio audience rating is also give brass true measurement of the product impact. Like people are watching not only on linear TV, they're also watching on connected TVs and all different kinds of screens. So again, they will have to do it. So if you see the diagram, like Nielsen in US, BARC in India, and Kantar Media in probably in US region and all, they measure all this impact, the total audience measurement. So this diagram from Nielsen, so if you see they have been covering all the digital and programs but again with a little sec, not much, the success is not there because the panel on the digital side is all based on some kind of software to download and based on that they are calculating. But ad, again, the way, as you know, that ad is a little complicated, the way it is measured, and that's how it is done. So well, Ashish, what do you think this kind of measurement on OTT? Will this be a standard for advertisers to invest in the advertising, hard-earned advertising budgets?
Yeah, here is what I think of that. Thanks for the questions. So TV ratings are key for audience measurement across different devices. This will be the most important data source for advertisers, primarily because they should know where to invest their advertising budgets, right? And for some time to come, before we hit any standardization button, right, on the OTT. So for from an OTT perspective, these companies will have to start looking at how to integrate their streaming statistics, right? And sometimes add impressions to measure the partner APIs on top of what is the internal rating. So while I understand Nielsen is launching a new TV rating mechanism, right, to improve the success on digital devices, do you want to talk about what Nielsen One looks like and how it's going to get some efficiency and improvement over the existing TV rating system?
Yeah, absolutely. So if you see, I don't know if it is, this is already in the public domain, Nielsen is going to update its existing TV rating mechanism to reflect a world where audiences are watching TV both live as well as on demand. Like video was left out, you can say, but across a variety of different streaming services and devices. So when Nielsen One launches, I think somewhere in 2022, the Nielsen going to report about the TV program, maybe it should reflect the true size of the audience. That's what the entire intention is. Not just the number of people watching on it, what is one only a linear story. So if you see the difference between the early methodology and the current one, this means the platform will be moving away from the traditional Nielsen's C3 and C7 rating, which are supposed to measure how many people saw a TV program within 3 and 7 days of airing it. Nielsen on One, in the other hand, will be much more granular. It will measure how many people saw each and ad across different platforms, not only on linear, but it will include all the devices as well. Each individual advertisement, like for advertisers, this is very important. Each individual advertisement will get an audience estimate number. So this is what digital rating, and this is how these different rating companies are moving on. So if you can cover the entire digital metrics, how it is different from the linear side of it, the rating side of it, that will be really great.
Sure. So let's spend some time, the previous slide. Let's spend some time on what is this video view, right? So if you look at the entire digital ecosystem, every platform is having its own definition of metrics. Some call it as video views, some call it as engagement measuring method. So you see two things here, right? The viewing platforms, which are your OTT players and things like that. And then there are engagement platforms. So look at the right, Netflix is measuring at the video viewers 2 minutes, right? And Facebook, if you look at Facebook, it's measuring it as 3 seconds. Instagram is also doing at 3 seconds. LinkedIn and Twitter are doing it 2 seconds or more as a video view. And YouTube is measuring it as 30 seconds. So you will see that there is a good amount of diversity in the measurement of these metrics itself, what the video view consists of. However, the most important aspect is that there all the revenue comes from the actual ad impressions and the performance of these ads, not just the TV ratings. So it is now up to the platform owners to decide what constitutes the view. There is no industry standard yet. So will it create a confusion in the minds of advertisers and marketers who are dependent on this? Absolutely, yes, right? So video views is not just, not at all a great indicator of the content watch. Not only that, but it's also a great metric to show what is the content popularity. So today, if you look at it, OTT platforms have various metrics. We'll talk through that today, which will analyze the user behavior, look at the ROI on investment, which will look at the active user pattern, and they'll see that how this is leveraged to actually improve the services. And not just that, they will also have to have a better storyline. And how do they do a programmatic content? So with so much of uncertainty here, we need to bring in a good amount of sanity. So we are looking at quite a bit of debate in the industry on what the right metrics look like, right, across the industry, just to have a cross-media comparability of TV. Now, if the industry body can define these definitions of these metrics, right, which will get traded, it'll be very helpful. In the case of ads, MRC has already defined this. So what should OTT adopt? Should it follow the TV style of measurement, or should it continue based on the data received from each user? So let me ask Aftab, right, what do you think? Should they still continue to report using traditional pay TV, or do you think that they should use metrics such as GRP? What should be the reach and frequency? What do you think, Aftab? How do we get better out of this data that's coming out of the digital platforms?
Yeah, so this is a very interesting question. Actually, they both will coexist for some time now, at least. So it is still reported separately, but these platform owners across Europe and even in the US or time-based viewing metrics are beginning to emerge in the OTT space as well, even in the streaming video channels, in support of the traditional TV reach and rating-based plannings. So in some countries, like industry bodies and research vendors, what they are doing is they're also releasing on-demand screen view analysis along with the traditional TV ratings. So in fact, they are reporting right of both. It will be very interesting to see how this emerges, how the reporting will emerge. But again, right now, the linear TV rating is also being reported on the OTT side as well.
So let's discuss a little bit about these OTT metrics, right, which are essential for success of OTT platforms. So there are many OTT content publishers which are not leveraging this data today, right, to improve the business. So as we all know, content is the king, and it's only true when we actually leverage the content services and apply that for OTT video services. So the value that is involved in the data analytics, right, on digital platforms is immense. So distribution of content across apps goes through various platforms, right? Like App Store, the device OS, each of the various types of data consumed to better understand the user content. So today we have started to look at these metrics in two categories. One from a growth and engagement. Second is revenue and marketing. So growth and engagement, this is all about what is essential to improve the services and understand the user behavior. From a revenue and marketing perspective, this is about tracking the return on investment, profitability, and what is used to report back to the CXOs and CMOs. So let me ask you, Aftab, if you want to give us a little more insight on the key metrics involved around these two categories and how do we calculate this, it may be worth for audience to know the various metrics and the calculation mechanisms.
Sure. So let's understand the metrics which give good insights about the growth and engagement of any OTT platform. If you see this MAU and DAU, which is actually monthly active users, daily active users, then another one is engagement rate, consumer retention rate, inactive users, average watch time. Actually, there are loads of good metrics. But if you compare all these 5 to 6 metrics, which gives a very good indication of how your platform is actually working and doing. So this becomes very important and critical for any platform to really succeed. So just to give an understanding of monthly active users, MAU is the number of unique users who have opened your app or website, engaged with your OTT service in the past 1 month. Daily is for the daily, on a daily basis. So it provides a very good overview of your health or health of your business. Like if the people are not coming and watching your content and opening a platform, that means you're not doing great. So MAU becomes a very good indicator of the health of your business. So that's why it is very, very important. So Ashish, what do you think about metrics, this MAU? Does this sound good for a success of a platform?
Yeah, I think it's a good indicator of repeat usage. But I'm just trying to understand how and what constitutes this as an important activity, right? So why don't you talk us through that?
Yeah, it's a very good indicator, no doubt. Say, for example, if a video view is taken into consideration, then active users will be more effective. Like if you're calculating your MAU and if you're just considering just an open app, then it doesn't give a very good indication about the MAU. If a user is actually opening your app and watching at least for some few seconds of your content, then that's a better indicator of just opening your app. So that's very important.
So I just think that these are other metrics as well, right? Which are effective and self-explanatory. But what will be interesting to know, Aftab, is how things like CRR, average watch time are measured. So do you want to give us a little bit more on the CRR and average watch time?
Yeah, absolutely. So CRR is the percentage of customers who stayed with your product after a certain period of time. Like if you have subscribed to a platform, how long he stays there, that and the percentage it becomes CRR. So this calculation is very simple. Like you can base your calculation on a number of downloads or first logins to your app, depending on the environment you are. So again, user at the end of the calculated period minus your new customer and divide the entire figure with the user at the start of the calculated period and make into a percentage. This is what CRR is. And similarly on the average watch time, this is one of my favorite metrics. Like this gives a very good indication of your health of your platform, how your, not even health of your platform, but even for about the quality of the content, or whether it's really working or not. This gives a amount of time spent playing a video. This also in this data also includes the replay, like the way, but like the moment you play a press a button, that also gets calculated. So that is how it is also include that. So the, just to get this figure, so what you can do is the, just calculate the amount of time spent playing a video, including replays, and divide by the total number of video plays. This will give a average watch time. This actually give a, it's a very good indicator of your, the quality of your content. All right. So again, this is, as Ashish said, that revenue market, this becomes very important for if you are really have to report to your management, this becomes very important. That these metrics are very useful for CMOs and other CXOs of our organization. Customer acquisition cost, average revenue, customer lifetime value, CLTV, which is also known as conversion rate, churn rate. So I will not go deep into each one of this, but again, the important thing is to understand the CAC, which we also call it, customer acquisition cost, is the total cost of acquiring a new customer. This can include a content production as well, acquisition cost as well. If you are a OTT provider and you have content, if you are acquiring content to place on your OTT platform, then you can include that as well. But generally, it includes your sales and marketing costs divided by the number of customers acquired. So this is a very useful metric to help calibrate your investment and ensure making the right decision for your services growth. So Ashish, do you think this content production or acquisition cost should also be included in CAC?
Well, it depends. It depends on the acquisition strategy. If it is acquired for a long period of time or a long duration, but definitely including it might make your ROI negative, but it will give a true picture of what the customer acquisition cost will look like after.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So now let's understand another metric, which is I thought is very useful and should be understood for internal consumption, but also understand the pricing study of your consumer base. Like it gives a very good pricing study for your platform, for your CXOs. So ARPU, like average revenue per user, this is very popular among the product managers and all, which measures the amount of money you expect to generate from one customer. It's calculated by dividing total revenue of the OTT business by its total number of users. That's how any business, any CXO, they will all ask you, what is your ARPU? So again, this ARPU is the important number. So another metric which I thought of actually discussing is the CLV or CLTV, customer lifetime value, which we call it, is the amount of money and a customer is expected to spend with you during their lifetime, on a single platform, by measuring CLTV in relation to cost of your customer acquisition. So average purchase value, multiply that number by the average subscription frequency rate to determine the customer value. Once you calculate average customer lifespan, you can easily multiply that by customer by value to determine customer lifetime value, such as the cost of sales and marketing. So while I'm speaking, it might not make sense. You should read that box over here. So that will give a proper calculation. Okay, let me move to next slide. Ashish, if you can cover this North Star metric.
Yeah, so North Star metrics, these are typical metrics which are important for any product or platform for on OTT, right? Which deals in content. And the most important success criteria is not just these metrics, but it's to understand whether your subscribers are liking or enjoying your content or not, because that is where the stickiness is. This can be understood by knowing the watch time of the content. We have seen earlier that how the video views are looked at, right? So, but what is a good average watch time? Do we know? There's some thought around this. If 50 to 60% of video length is decent, 60% above should be performing quite well. So however, as per the cable bills calculation, if you look at it, Netflix users are actually watching at an average about 3.5 hours of Netflix video per day on these streaming platforms, compared to an average of about 2 hours per day way back in 2019. So this predicts that there are about 63 million Netflix users in the United States, which they are watching about 203 million hours of Netflix content. I mean, that's amazing, isn't it? Mm-hmm. From the time we have seen pandemic hitting us. So if this is what it means to the US users we are watching, and what does it mean in terms of the overall hours? So today we look at about, in 1 month, 6.1 billion hours of Netflix per month. And that's nearly like 700,000 years, and which is humongous, right? And North Star metrics, we're also using the abbreviation NSM. So there are two metrics that we use here. Active users, which is called the daily active usage or a monthly active usage, DAU or MAU. Then we also try to understand what the fill rate for AVOD business looks like. The first step for growing any channel's business is to understand what drives growth. The OTT data analytics today could give a comprehensive use of the video business. So there are four things to take away, right? So customer count to see how your subscription base is growing over time, which is very essential. Then there is a gross customer lifetime value that we are talking about here, which automatically is calculated based on your gross revenue per user during using a historical churn rate. Then there's a paid churn, the percentage of subscribers that have canceled in the past 30 days. I'm sure you have seen that if your video hits a buffering mode, maybe within 5 to 7 seconds, you kind of switch over to your next available streaming platform, right? So that's also a churn. It need not be the subscription churn, but it also maybe a usage churn. And the last thing is average new trial signups. There are many new trial signups that happen, and how many trials are getting converted into paid subscriptions. So Aftab, this ecosystem looks very huge and complex, right? You want to tell us what are the different points that are there in this, and why is this so complex?
Yeah, absolutely. So if you see the diagram, so you can easily see the complexity. Like once you have a data analytics platform, so you have to not get data from various sources. Like this OTT ecosystem is that complex. So you cannot actually work in only one platform or this thing. You have to gather data from different sources. Like suppose on a mobile app, when you are publishing an app on mobile devices, on iOS and Android, they have their own ecosystem. Similarly on smart TV, you have Samsung, then Android TV is there, then Apple TV is there. There are so many devices are there. So, and similarly, this is all client side, but again, even for measuring, like from different sources, like some data from say App Store, you have to really get like the number of downloads which has happened and the active users. So, and if you have a subscription-based platform, then again, the data, you have to really get it from the payment gateway. Then if you are the award business, advertiser video on demand, then you have to really see what's your ad server, and you have to really get this data from the third-party services. And there are, again, there if you are really into B2B or B2C, again, so all this data has to be really get into one place, crunch, and make sense out of it. So it's quite complex. So if you really don't define that metrics well, and the architecture well, it becomes very, very difficult later. So yeah, on that aspect, so let me show what are the different challenges, right? So no one thing it has to be noted is that no available single platform today which can independently cover the increasingly diverse and fragmented ecosystem of multi-platform video distributors. There is not a single system. Many OTT platforms, because the way they are developed, some are developed in native, some are in hybrid, using different technologies, and getting those tracker is becoming difficult. Like you might be having a very different kind of video player. Some people use third-party video players, all become very different. And third-party sources, like if you're getting all data from different third-party sources, that certain times what happens, like SDK is not available. Then again, if you're also getting SDK, then data latency is there. See, all this makes it very, very difficult. SDK, right? Even for example, like Firebase SDK is mostly on iOS and Android, but it's not there on smart TV. But again, these days OTT, the most of the evolvement or development is happening on the smart TV side. So if you don't have that proper SDK, it makes life difficult to really calculate. And then again, video player metrics, right? This is also important. How many times a person is actually playing, how long he's playing. These sometimes certain tools, like they are calculating out of the box. A certain time you have to really do as a event-based calculation. So all these things, if you see, this makes life very difficult. So the measurement becomes very difficult. So when you're actually planning the entire analytics and all, you have to make sure that this all planned well and the architecture should be proper so that the calculation becomes easier and consistent all across. So I will also talk about app, because award is also very important. Like, so there are many advantages that OTT can offer, right, which regular TV advertising cannot. Like on linear TV, the most of the advertising happens because of the target demographics according to ratings and time of the day. Whatever ratings we explained in the previous slide, that's how it is. The advertisers pay for VOC based on the VOC rating, not actual consumption. So this is a difference. And the actual VOC is always stimulated and not precise. VOC location is also not very clear. But in terms of OTT, whereas advertising on OTT, we can target customers according to the needs, interest, and location. Like ad performance can be tracked in real time, reports giving ad managers the ability to optimize as they go. Like on real time also they can optimize, but on TV you cannot. So however, there are still some challenges, obviously, though it looks very very promising, but there are still some challenges. So the major challenges right now we should discuss, I think, in the interest of time, but let's make it short. So unified ID measurability, like we don't have a measurement like in the industry-wide unified ID, like every platform having the same user being counted twice, which makes it the frequency cap on that user advertisement becomes the problem to calculate, and they are not able to calculate. If a person is really watching, if advertiser is actually marking it to ad to be shown only four times, but again, they are not able to really cap that advertisement. Similarly on the privacy and regulations, because of the GDPR, we are not able to do a targeted advertisement. So all these are because of privacy laws. And also on the technology side, if you see the functionality of most of the OTT device all differs. Like browser, you can have a tracking, cooking tracking and calculate, but on smart TV, you cannot. So these are all challenges on ad as well. So we have to define a solution. We can really cover all these things. So moving on to some best practices for analytic implementation. So the most important thing is really you have to really define the architecture before implementation. What happened, like what I've seen in reality, in my experience also, but if you're launching on say one device, then we used to define the architecture only for that device. And then similarly, we keep on adding devices. And at some point of time, it becomes very, very complex. So again, those things has to be avoided at all costs. Again, otherwise, when you are planning it, you should plan for all the devices at one. Obviously, there are certain devices which you cannot even think of if some other new devices come. But again, your planning architecture should be very consistent across platform. And you also think about the rolling up reporting, right? If you are getting data from all different sources, you have to make sure that what are the latency and what time, certain times what happens, like one platform is giving a data on real time, but the other platform is not giving a real time. So which actually makes it difficult. So you have to really define that. Plus I think this is also important for a lot of players. Like if mostly people, they use third party solution, then that, and the charging is based on number of parameters. So again, you should also keep in mind, because I have a pretty bad experience earlier. Like we keep using it and it was overused, and we did a great billing, and you can understand now. Yeah. Then again, regular audits will happen every time. This audit is very important. Like if the data is collecting proper, like certain times what happens is that this platform, they keep changing the data format. So again, in that case, you have to have defined an audit mechanism when every time the data is coming properly, so that there's no mismatch, or there's no garbage is coming. So all these things come in mind. Yeah, so we move on to next slide. So we have discussed about various metrics, like in the previous slides, we have discussed about MAU, DAU, active users, and CA, but how do we really get this data? This is also important, right? But what about the tools and technologies to use, collect and calculate this metric? In any OTT platform, there's no one size fits all. No single measurement tool can perfectly capture all media exposure, conversion, even sales data, all these, there are multiple of systems. So OTT application pose new challenges when broadcasters, content providers, and even service providers are trying to understand the performance of OTT content in a holistic manner. Compiling data in ever-growing number of data sources is exhaustive and time-consuming while trying to make meaningful data out of the clutter. So automating this data aggregation from diverse data sets is critical to providing tools. There is a huge variety of choice, as you know, Ms. Dagan, if you can see in the diagram, there are, if you're on the ad business, then ad unity becomes important, and platform like Moat gives mostly people use it, and again, Comscore is there. Then on the consumer journey and personalized, and there are various tools like you can use Segment, they can use M-Practice, then Adopt CTP is always there. Then we also have, GlobalLogic also have a framework called Prime, which works on a customer data management platform. Then attribution, like if you'll be running a lot of campaigns, then attribution campaign becomes important. In all the scenarios, you're actually using different various kind of tools. So there are huge variety of choices regarding the technology that collects data for video quality, monetization, marketing, user behavior. So we have already explained this one. So every platform have their own ecosystem. So you have to really keep those things in mind as well. So what tools to use and what technologies to use to collect all this data. So Ashish, what do you think of these so many different kinds of tools? Will it make data collection and insight more difficult?
Yeah, I think, thanks, Saftav. This is a heavy list of tools, very comprehensive too. What more important is not the tools that are out in the market, but it is picking the right tool, because that becomes the X factor, right? So we should actually start looking at the purpose for which we are using this tool, right? In what business context do we need these tools? Do we need this for personalization? Do we need this for attribution tracking? Do we need to measure the audience viewing patterns? Is there a way for us to get a better personalization? Do we need this for analytics around platform and video? I think there's a good amount of thought that needs to go into it, and we should not jump into doing a trial and error on production systems, which can be catastrophic. And we have seen time and again how, if you go and try something out in the production system, what kind of impact it can create. So this is a good list, and it needs expert advice. And we definitely need to have people who can spend some time analyzing the purpose and then going back to the tools. That's what I think. So with that, Aftab, thank you so much for enlightening us with these tools. We come to the end of today's session. I just want to recap what we have covered so far. A quick recap. So we have discussed the linear TV measurement, how the TV rating measurement works, what does Nielsen look for, Nielsen One platform, how is it creating efficiencies, how is the shift happening from a pay TV to a cord cutter mode, we're moving to OTT, and how the different digital devices have come into play for total audience measurement. Then there are digital platforms and metrics on digital platforms and OTT. Then we also looked at the two categories on growth and engagement and revenue marketing. And we also discussed a few North Star metrics, right? And also we went through the different measurement challenges and whatnot in terms of best practices and tools. So I just want to open up the floor for questions. I'm seeing questions coming in. Thank you all for putting the questions. So I'll talk through these questions of time, and let's see how we can answer most of them that we can. Otherwise, I think we'll definitely leave our response back on our websites, right? So let's go back to the Q&A, and then let's start looking at what our teams are asking.
Yeah.
All right. So got it. So team, if you can put your questions in the Q&A section, not in the chat, very appreciated. All right, so I'll see the first one. Nikhil is asking, if you don't have Google account, then Google Analytics will not work. So in such case, how should we approach? Aftab, do you want to talk us through the number of tools that we have?
Let me understand the question. If we don't have Google account, the Google Analytics will not work. In such a case, what should be our option? So again, you have to use some kind of tool, right? Some kind of platform. Like if you don't have a tool, how will that happen? Like you have to subscribe to one particular tool. So if alternative is there, various tools, Mixpanel is there. Well, other services are there are services, some provide free, some provide, some are paid. Adobe Analytics is one of the premium one. For enterprise level analytic tools, that becomes very important.
Got it. So thanks, Aftab. The second question Dheeraj is asking, it's a good question. Is there any optimum percentage for these metrics like MAU, DAU, ERR, CRR, right? So how do you get the maximum revenue for the OTT platform? How do we measure this?
So active is, if you see in the case of Facebook, like 2 billion, right? What is active users? So active users are calculation of number of people on different platforms. So again, the more the active users is all about reporting. Like Facebook reports they on the board via active users. Similarly, platform like Netflix and Hotstar, they report on that number of subscriptions. It's all depend on that. So and the revenue will always obviously will depend on the kind of monetization method they have. But that becomes important. Like if they are is an award based system, then again the different kind of metrics will come. If it is a subscription based, again different kind of metrics will come. That's how it will be.
Sure. Avinash, we'll share this video recording after the today's webinar. We'll put it live. You can start looking at it. So Aftab, is there any set of open source tools that you want to talk about for someone who want to do a quick R&D and then check the efficiency of these tools?
Yeah, there are loads, but one of the good tools is called some Moto or something. I'm just forgetting that. It's a very good tool. I can get back on that, but this I just forgot. Some Moto or something. It is a very good tool. We have used that. And for a certain number, it also allows you to download that tool and you can install it. You don't need to really depend on the cloud base or something. You just simply you can install on your platform and just count. But again, as the data grows, as your user base grows, you have to also scale up your infrastructure as well.
Got it. Do you want to compare a little bit on Adobe Analytics versus Google Analytics tools and how they compare against each other and where they fare better versus the other?
Yeah, so if you say that Google Analytics, there are two kinds of services. Like one is a free one, Google Analytics. The other one is a 360, Google 360. So Google 360 is an enterprise level and Google Analytics is a free one. It is up to certain limit, it is free. After that, they just sample the report. They don't give a actual report on user base. So if you see that Google, the free one, the data which is there, you can keep only to 26 months or something. You cannot keep more than that. But in respect to Adobe, which is a premium one, which is a paid one. So again, as long as your subscription lasts, it will be able to use that. Plus OTT services, like if you are having OTT, if you are trying to use this analytics platform for OTT services, There are different SDKs which they have made it for available for all the platforms. Google doesn't have that SDK for all the platforms, though you can use your event-based API. But Google Analytics comes with their own SDK for Roku, for Samsung, all the devices. Mostly they have SDK which you can calculate all those different kinds of metrics for video analytics as well.
Got it. Thank you. So if someone wants to come to GlobalLogic and understand how to use Adobe Analytics and then get benefit out of that. So can we offer something? Do you want to talk about some of those aspects?
Yeah, at GlobalLogic, we have a good practices on Google Analytics actually, because not only we work with different tools, we also work with different cloud services like AWS Red Sea. We can collect data not only in S3 and populate the data on AWS Red Sea and use various tools for visualization, not only for visualization, even for streaming data we work with. So we have a very good practice at GlobalLogic. Obviously, you're welcome to really explore that and ask if you can help us, how they can reach out to us and if we can really tell them how it works.
Absolutely, sure. Thank you. So Avinash, I think we will share this presentation with you. So you asked a question whether these tools are real time or do you need to stage data? I think there are both types of tools. So when Aftab was comparing Adobe Analytics versus Google Analytics, so some of these have real time, some of these are staged real time, right? So Aftab, you want to talk about the 24-hour delay, things like that?
Yeah, not 24-hour delay, but some reports are delayed. But mostly like a year back, Adobe never used to give real time. But again, many reports, important reports they used to give, but other report the university. But right now they are actually providing. So the difference is actually, if you see the both, the difference is minimizing in terms of real time report. But Google Analytics gives even for the free version.
Yeah. So for a country like India, so not everyone may have a smart TV, right? So we may be dealing with Amazon Fire Stick or like Google Chromecast or whatnot, right? So if we go beyond smart TVs and look for some of these streaming devices, streaming sticks, so what kind of tools can we use?
So again, for enterprise level, I'll talk about in from enterprise level. So Adobe is a very good tool. Like they have the SDKs for all the media, for media as well, the media SDK. So it is able to help capture all those different, obviously you have to configure those. You have to capture all those play level event, what kind of data it is there. That is one kind of, that is more on the consumer analytics. They also have for calculating, like even Mux is there, then Conviva is there. What they do is they also calculate the user experience, whether the buffering is happening or not, those other things are happening, but those all are captured. Like they are various tools. Obviously, you can also build from scratch, but again, it takes its own sweet time. But the tools are available. And I don't know about open source in this area, but on enterprise level, there are various tools.
Yeah, good question, Tribhuvan. I think we'll definitely talk beyond this to look for how the streaming sticks and the tools that are relevant for that. A good host of questions. Thank you all for keeping us engaged. This is extremely good. We are very happy. If there are any other questions, happy to answer. Otherwise, I think we would like to wrap up this session, and we definitely wait. Please wait for our next session that's coming up. So we will announce it in a short time around the OTT platforms and the different real-time mechanics. All right. Thank you all. It was a pleasure talking to each one of you. And thank you, Aftab, for being co-host. And thank you, Jill, for helping us with this whole presentation.